Good morning. It's wonderful to be here together on such a morning to our live stream. People that are watching, welcome to you as well. And we're glad to be here together. A couple of announcements as we continue. There is a fellowship time downstairs, and 4 dozen butter tarts have been prepared. So if you're not concerned that that might spoil your lunch, then you can come down and have some butter tarts. Thank you to the people that are hosting that fellowship time. The Sunday school this morning is led by Kim McCallum and Linda Ford, so thank you very much to them. And just after the children's time and the quartet sings, that the kids can head out and you can pick them up in the lower hall following. We have an awesome quartet that is singing with us this morning, 2 songs. Applause before you even sing. That's pretty good. James Carson, Mike Hughes, Trevor Hanley, and Nathan Hanley. And they'll be singing their first of the 2 songs in just a few minutes. We have had just an awesome weekend. We had such fun here Friday night. I'm curious, just show of hands, how many of you were able to come to Friday? At least half. We had 450 people in this room for the first time since Christmas of 2019. And we just had an awesome time. So we have a couple of pictures to show you, just if you weren't there, that give you a general idea of what we did. We had a kids ensemble, a youth ensemble. I love this picture. Hold this picture just for a second, Murray. This is Jessica Mills along with Allison leading the kids' ensemble. Oftentimes we get pictures of the performers but not pictures of the directors. So this conveys the excitement of the directors. So that's just one of my favorite pictures. I warned you, Connor. I'm sorry. I warned you. That's Connor, who played the drums, and Angela, who was in the ABBA presentation. Those are some of the performers from the We Don't Talk About Bruno, and that was awesome. A couple from the ABBA presentation. We had Anne-Marie Marsden back, so that was a lot of fun to see Anne-Marie, and she's there with Joan. And there is Josh Hanley doing his Tele song, which was just absolutely spectacular if you saw it. You know what I'm talking about, just so much fun with the Matilda. This woman will live in my nightmares forever. This is Trenchbull, and she was a little bit creepy, really, wasn't she? But lots of fun as well. Jazz hands from there were 70 people in the presentation, everything included, all the ensembles included, so just pretty spectacular. Here's a video. We had two different piano parts going there. Gosh, that was fun. Appropriate to show on in a worship service, a song called A Little Bit Naughty, but that was, I don't know who picked that one, but somebody did. And there's the ensemble there. We take a picture after the show, and thank you for your support. We didn't know if we'd be able to do it a couple months ago, so it was pretty awesome that we were able to do it. So lots of fun. Church Picnic is actually 2 weeks from today, and we're going to have sign-up sheets at the Welcome Center next week. Just if you're able to come, just bring some kind of food item, and we'll look forward to that. We just do it on the Beach Street property. Hopefully we'll get a nice sunny day. Kids Corner Craft, led by Fiona McGaw and Barb McKenzie, is on this Wednesday the 15th at 4:30 at the church. Kids Corner Craft. More information on the website regarding that. And just a reminder from the VBC Snack Committee, there's sign-up sheets for VBC snacks, so they need all kinds of stuff like cookies and apples and other things. So please sign those sheets up, and that would be great. Lastly, Gord McCallum, as he did, there's Gord. Please come forward, Gord. Thank you. And it's a requirement from Presbytery. This is probably what Gord's going to say, so I won't say anything else. Thanks for being here, Gord. Use your mic, Haven. This is Haven's mic, Al.
Good morning. Good morning. Can you hear me?
It's coming.
Can you hear me with this mic?
It's muted.
If everybody's signing up for the picnic.
It's muted.
No, it's not.
It's not.
It's green out.
There we go. Okay. So if anybody's signing up for the picnic next week, pecan pie is one of my favorites, so. I have to read this for the second time as requested by Presbytery. It's a citation in the case of resignation. Reverend Tim Rayburn Gibson, minister of this congregation, having laid his resignation before the Presbytery of Barrie, the Presbytery hereby cites the session and congregation to appear at the meeting of Presbytery by chosen representatives to be held using the Zoom format on the 14th day of June in the year 2022 at 7:45 p.m., that they may give reasons, if they have any, why Reverend Tim Rayburn Gibson's resignation should not be proceeded with certification that if no appearances be made, they shall be held as consenting to his resignation. In order to facilitate this citation, the session is asked to appoint two representatives to attend and when called upon to speak to the Presbytery, Reverend Dr. Jim Sidler. Now, to Presbytery's request, the session appoint two representatives of the congregation to speak on their behalf. With the session's approval, both Jack Vanderkoy and Frank Tilley, if I could ask you guys to stand up so people can see you, because you've been not very visible for the last 2 years because of COVID, have both accepted request to represent the congregation and session respectively. Both were picked because they both speak well, know this church well, and know Tim well. Both Jack and Frank have been active in this church's life for many years and have contributed to its well-being before, during, and after COVID. Thank you, Jack and Frank, for taking on this request. Also speaking will be Shirley McAlpine. Ask you to stand, Shirley. A little bit higher.
Oh, she's going to get you for that one.
And myself, in our capacities as Chair of Staff Relations and Clerk of Session. As I said last week, we will be keeping everyone advised as to what's going on. And the best way to do that actually is through Marlene and the MailChimp. So probably next week after the Presbytery meeting and our session meeting on Wednesday, we'll have a bit more information for you as to the transition this church is going to go through in the next few months. Thank you very much.
Oh, Gord, this is yours, I think. Our freakishly tall clerk of session. Let's pray. God, thank you for this day. Thank you for the rain last night that just nourishes the ground. And again, we're surrounded by growth and green, and we never tire of seeing that as a symbol of new life. God, in this worship, we remember that you have us in the palm of your hand, that you have a good future for those who trust you and do their best to follow your direction. And God, we are so glad to know that you have us guarded in that way. God, in this place, we remember beautiful promises. Today, we remember the promise of family and what it means to belong to this church family and to the body of Christ. We know how precious it is to belong to a family. And so we remember that promise today and we celebrate it together. God, be with us here in this abiding presence that is always strong. Guide us and comfort us. Help us as we celebrate who you are today, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Such a special treat that we're going to hear in just a minute. I'm very excited. And I know you'll be. You will be too once you hear. Come on up. So nice to see you today. So, you know, in this church, we talk about how we all have things that we do that we're good at, right? And those things that we do that we're good at are given to us by God. And one word that we can use for those things that we do that we're good at is a talent. So each one of you has a talent inside of you that was given to you by God. And you might not even know what it is yet, because you're still pretty young, right? So as you grow, you might discover that talent. But we all have different talents, and the miraculous thing is that when we put them together, when Molly puts her talent together with Elizabeth's or with Haven's, and we put them together, we get an incredible thing that can go out into the world and be a light, be the light of Jesus when we put all those things together. Now, we're going to listen to the quartet sing before you go down, and I want you to listen to the different parts of the singing, because some voices are high, and that person that sings high, he's good at singing high, and then some voices are lower, and some voices are kind of in the middle. And I want you to listen to the amazing way that all of those voices come together to make one thing, to be a light into the world. And not just their voices, they have to use mics. So Al's up there with, and Kimberly is playing piano, and everybody's using all the things that they're good at, and it's all going to come together to make something really, really nice. Okay, so that's what I want you to think about as we're listening. And we're going to get up and we're going to sit right in that center aisle, because they're going to be standing here, and if we sit here, we're just going to be looking at their backs. So let's get up and let's just sit right in the center on the floor, and we'll have a really good view, and I'll invite the quartet to come up. Let's have a seat right here.
And the poor get together with the Lord. Get together with the Lord. Well, they will treat each other like sister and brother when they all get together with the Lord.
Now when
they all get together. Together with the Lord.
Well, they will treat
each other like sister and brother when they all get together with the Lord.
Now, when the tall and the small get together with the Lord, get together with the Lord. Well, the are no longer afraid of the stronger when they all get together with the Lord.
Now when they all get together, when they all get together with the Lord,
well, they will treat
each other like sister and brother when they all get together with the Lord. Well, God has no favorites, He just loves us all the same. His Son died to save us and to keep us in His name. And soon we'll rise to meet Him, and forever we will reign, and we will sing, 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 sing. Now when they all get together, when we all get together with the Lord,
well, we will treat each other like sister and brother
when we all get together.
Quartet. Wasn't that great, guys? All right, well, we're happy that you could be up here to hear their first song anyway, and you can head down to the Sunday school now, and we will see you in a little bit. Fantastic. So often songs just don't seem like they're long enough. They end so quickly. And Connor, I didn't mention Connor, people taking part in the, oh, sorry, Connor. A I'm just talking about family today and what it means to be family. We talk about family a lot at this church. If you've attended this church, you know that being a part of family is important to us. So this is a short reading from the Gospel of Mark in chapter 3 that has us wondering about what family means to Jesus. So let's read this together. If you have your Bible, you can actually open it up to the Bible in chapter 3 at that verse. Then Jesus' mother and brothers arrived. Standing outside, they sent someone in to call him. A crowd was sitting around Jesus, and they told him, "Your mother and brothers are outside looking for you." "Who are my mother and my brothers?" Jesus asked. And then he looked at those seated in a circle around him, and he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother." This is the word of the Lord for us today. Thanks be to God. What is it that makes family? Is it flesh and blood? Is that what makes family? Of course, that's one way family is made, one way family is understood. As a part of Little Night Music, I felt like for the whole time we were practicing, for the whole time we were performing, I just felt like I was with family. All the people that I was with for Little Night Music just felt like family to me. When we have session meetings here, I feel like I'm sitting with family. Well, not all session meetings, but some of them. Some of them I do. It depends what we're talking about. Sometimes that family feeling isn't quite as evident, but I just feel like these people are my family. I know these people, I've done things with these people, I've served with these people. It's my family. The quartet sang these words. "Now when the rich and poor get together, now when the tall and small get together, they will treat each other like sister and brother when they're together." Being together makes us family. When they're together, they're sister and brother. So that's kind of a simple way of thinking about family when we're together. But then there were the words "with the Lord." When the rich and poor get together with the Lord. So being family isn't just about being together, it's about being together with the Lord. In some way, there is a God presence when we're together that makes us this kind of family. That short passage from the Bible, Jesus' mother. I mean, there are passages in the Bible that are intended to crack a smile. There really are, and this is one of them. Jesus is sitting in a house teaching. His mother shows up, knocks on the door. Somebody says, "Jesus, your mom's here." And he says, "Who's my mom? Who is my mother?" What? In this passage, Jesus gives us a new definition of family. That somehow has something to do with something that God brings. Being together creates family, but in a church context, there is also this God presence that creates what we understand as church family. We know that Jesus gives definitions of words, new definitions. Jesus defines power in a whole different way. Like, if someone asked you, how would you define power? How does the world define power? We'd all think of the same three or four words: money, status, education, talent. Those would be the four top words. Power is none of those things for Jesus. It's a redefinition of the word power. For Jesus, power is love for your neighbor and forgiveness. Love for your neighbor and forgiveness. Jesus says that's where the power is in the world that you live in. It has nothing to do with how much money you have or how high people think you are up in the social stratus. That doesn't have anything to do with power. It's a redefinition. How would you define family? Same blood, same parents, same grandparents make us family. What about same background? You know, if you come from the same region and you used to do all the same things when you were a kid, you kind of feel like family. Maybe passion, if you share the same passion, like Leafs Nation. Oh, sorry, James, that's not you. No, it's a Red Wings guy, I think. No, but I mean, you know, Leafs Nation, that's family. Like, we've been in our family, we've been bleeding blue for a long, long time. If we have the same passion, we're in the same family, maybe you can think about family in that way. Does family have something to do with belonging? Of course it does. It has something to do with how important it is for us to belong. And if any of you have had like teenagers in the house, you know the importance of tribes. Like, you just need to belong to something. It's just so important. This article in the Globe and Mail, it was a couple of years ago, I found it interesting. It's about how people are more isolated than ever, lonelier, which is ironic because in this day and age, we have social media to keep us connected. We have 24/7 news, but yet people are lonelier and more isolated than ever because those community halls that used to exist in every town and in every city neighborhood, they're dormant now. Nobody goes into the community halls anymore. We're just all on social media. And the study says people are just isolated. There is this BBC report. This is kind of funny. It said Danish people, any Danes here? Not a one. Danish people are among the happiest people in the world. Why? Not because they eat cinnamon Danishes all the time, and not because they breed the biggest dogs in the world, according to this report. It's because the majority of Danes are involved in their communities. How simple is that? They spend more time together. They do more things together. And the author of that research wrote this: "In all the work that I have done within the field of happiness research, this is the point I am surest about." And this is where we lean forward. It's kind of like, oh, this is an expert on happiness, and now he's going to tell us, he's going to say, this is what's going to make you happy. The best predictor of whether or not we are happy is our social relationships. Having people around you who say, I'm here for you. When we have that, we celebrate it. And then I read this other thing, like Snoop Dogg, the hip-hop, the rap artist Snoop Dogg. I'm not making this up. You can Google this. He recorded a gospel album in 2019 called Snoop Dogg Presents the Bible of Love. And he had hits. It's legit. He had hits on the gospel chart. And here's what he says, like, this is amazing. There are dangerous places in the dark streets of Philadelphia. My homies, they walk with me, they know me, they know how I think and how I walk and how I talk. I was brought up with no father. Most of my friends were brought up with no father. It's the only family I had, and it's the only family I needed. And he said, almost every male hip-hop and rap figure that grew up in the United States grew up like that without a father. And so their friends were their family. This church, as we have talked about, is called family. What is it that makes us family in particular? When I joined my home church in London, Oak Ridge, I will never forget. I know I've told you this before, but I became a member of that church, and I walked up just like new members walk up here when they join. And I shook Terry Ingram's hand, who was the senior minister, and he just said, welcome to the family. Welcome to the family. And those words meant so much to me because at the time I was a single parent. Ian was this high and Taylor was this high, and it was not a good time in my life. And welcome to the family meant so much to me because I needed to belong to something. And maybe there are people here today or people watching who are in that same position. They just need to belong to something, and they're in a difficult time of their life. And if they come into a church community and somebody says with some authenticity, welcome to the family, it is life-giving. What is it that makes us a family in particular? Well, the Bible's full of stories, and we can go for the answer right back to Genesis 1:1. God created humankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created male and female. We all come from the same source. This was so important to Jesus in his teaching. When Jesus prayed, he prayed to Abba. And Abba is an intimate Arabic expression that means either daddy or mummy. Jesus knew that there is only one source for all people, and that's why he went out and included all people. There wasn't anybody that Jesus didn't talk to. And I'm convinced if people believe in their hearts and understand that there is only one source for all people in the world, there could not possibly be any racism that exists. If you really believe that we're all from one source and that everybody's your brother, how could there be any racism? How could there be any inequality? How could there be any gender inequality? If we all truly believe that in the beginning God created all humankind. And then a little bit later in Genesis, there's this garden, and God's walking around in a garden with two human beings that are named Adam and Eve. And God has a relationship with these two people. Like, there's just a give and take, there's discussion. And then they made a bad choice, and they had to leave the garden. They chose not to listen to the voice of God. But in that story, we see that there's a relationship that is intimate. This is something that we have in common as a church family. We believe together that we can be intimately related to the creator of the universe. That's what we have in common. That's what makes us family. A couple of generations later, God said to Abraham, I will make you into a great nation. But first you're going to have to leave your home. Well, where are we going to go, God? Sarah and Abraham said. He said, I'm not going to tell you yet. You're just going to have to trust me on this one. I want you to leave your home and I want you to go to this place. And from that story, we learn that God, see, Abraham was not a perfect person. He was a pretty average guy. And God just chose Abraham. And we learn that what comes out of that story is this God of grace and promise. Where are we going to go, God? I'm not going to tell you, but you're going to have to trust me on this one. But I promise you, if I'm leading you somewhere, you're going to get there and it's going to be a good place. And that applies for all of us. And that's what we have in common, because we all believe that that's who God is. That's what makes us a family and a church. And then when Israel was in Egypt, they were slaves of the Pharaoh, and they cried out to God for help, and God heard their cries and sent Moses to free them. And Moses is like, I'm not the guy, but he was the guy. And he went, and Pharaoh freed them. And in that story, we hear that God hears the cries of the oppressed. And if you are in that position today, you have to know that God knows what you're going through. And that God will answer your cry and deliver you from whatever Egypt you're living in. That's what we have in common as a church family. The first thing that characterizes Christian family are all these things. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will not fear. For God, you lead us to green pastures, and it's a promise that we believe and that we hold together as a family and a church. The one thing I'd like to say before the last point, Christian families are not perfect. Unless you want to raise your hand and say you are, that's fine. Biblical families are so far from perfect. Have you ever walked into a church, looked around and thought to yourself, everybody's so perfect but me? Have you ever felt that? It's as you look around, you go, that, he's got it together, and he's got it, and their kids are all doing well, and you just look, and it's like, it's just so far from the truth. Biblical families are way more like Archie and Edith Bunker than they are like Ward Cleaver and June. I mean, they're just not, all through the Bible, families are just decidedly imperfect. Jacob and Esau, brothers that formed the nation of Israel, they never got along until there were old men with long white beards. Jacob had all kinds of problems before he was named Israel. There's just Cain and Abel. I mean, you know that story. Joseph, the one with the amazing technicolor dream coat, his brothers threw him in a hole. Biblical families are far from perfect, but here's the point. It's not about being righteous and perfect all the time, because we will never be that, any of us. It's about seeing how God works even through our imperfections and molds us into something that God wants to see us be. That's the point of recognizing how imperfect we are, because God will take that and mold it into something. And then Jesus takes it to a whole other level in this last point. This is such an interesting passage. It seems a little harsh in some way. He's in a house, he's teaching. Well, the text doesn't even say he's teaching, he's just in a house. But people are sitting around him, so he probably is. And his mom and brothers come to the door, they rap on the door. Jesus, your mom's here. Who's my mom? You just imagine them standing outside that door, trying to look in. It's us. And the disciples are like, what? Jesus, it's your mom. Like, what about that honor thy mother and thy father? I mean, they must have had some questions. Actually, Jesus isn't brushing his mother off at all. Jesus had a wonderful relationship with his biological mother. She was one of the only ones that sat at the foot of the cross when he was dying. And his brothers, his brother James was the leader of the early church and wrote the book of James in the New Testament. Jesus is just making a simple point that in the Spirit of God, his family just got a whole lot bigger than blood, than who he's related to by blood. It now will include anyone, gentle, Gentile, Jew, man or woman, slave or free. The only criteria is this. And this is just what everything hinges around. For people to be in my family, sorry, just the next one there, Murray. Oh, that's, there it is, thank you. Oh, here it is. Listen, whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother. Huh. Whoever does God's will, you mean if I meet someone on the street and they're doing God's will and I'm doing God's will, then we're family? Yeah. Whoever does God's will, so this is just taking it to a whole other level. Like, we might believe that we are children of God, and we might believe that God hears our cries, and we might believe that God is just leading us to it, and we might believe all of that stuff. But Jesus says now, you have to live it. You believe it, and then you have to live it. The word do is so interesting. He says, for people to be in my family, they must do the word, the will of God. He doesn't say, for people to be in my family, they must believe in the will of God. He just says the word do. It's just, it's like a proactive word. It's not a passive word. It's like, you just have to do it. Oh, God, it's so hard. It's just so hard. I get up every morning and I try to do the will of God. And Jesus said, that's why I leave you with the Holy Spirit. The problem with you, Jesus said, and me, is that we forget sometimes. We forget the Holy Spirit is with us to help. We do. It's like you go through a day and you just haven't thought about it once. And Jesus, I know it's hard to love your neighbor. I know it's hard to forgive, but you have to rely on the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit, because Jesus said over and over, the Holy Spirit will help you. That's a promise. The Holy Spirit will comfort you. It's like you wrap yourself in a comforter on a cold winter's night. It's the same thing. The Holy Spirit will guide you in the right direction. Jesus, it's so hard to do the will of God, then don't rely on your own power. There are so many people in this church who will testify to the power of the Spirit abiding in them and coming up alongside. So many people will testify to that power. It might not happen exactly in the way you think it's going to happen, and it might not happen at the time you want it to happen, but it will. Anyone who does the will of God is in my family. When we celebrated John Diston's life a couple weeks ago, we remembered that he was a man of faith. We remembered that he believed all these things, that he's a child of God, that God is leading him, that he walks. All of these things we remember that he believed as a Christian person. But then we also remember that he lived them out, which was such a joyous thing to celebrate. He was kind. That's the will of God. Be kind. He lived with a servant's heart. That's the will of God. Live with a servant's heart. Put other needs above your own. He was a blessing to those around you. He lived out those ancient words that God gave to Abraham. You are blessed that you might be a blessing to others. And so today, as we look at this family, we remember that there's just one house rule in this church, because every family has house rules. You have house rules in your family. You take your shoes off, you go in the house. You eat your supper. You don't just leave your dish on the table. You take your dish, you put it in the sink. You never eat supper in front of the TV. No yelling in the house. You all have house rules in your house. There's only one house rule in this church. If you want to be in the family, do everything according to the will of God. It's worth it, because there will be a day for each one of us. There will be a day someday when we will stand before Jesus himself. Every single one of us will stand before Jesus. And Jesus will say to you, you did my will. You did the will of God in your life. And he will welcome you into his family. Thanks be to God. Let's sing. Quartet again. Gentlemen, thank you so much again for being here.
To glory, children, my Lord and I. We're gonna walk and tell the story, children, my Lord and I. When I come to the river wide, the blessed Lord is gonna calm the tide. We're gonna walk this road to glory, children, my Lord and I.
Yes, we're gonna
walk this road to glory, children, my Lord and I. We're gonna walk and tell the story, children, my Lord and I. When I come to the river wide, the blessed Lord is gonna calm the tide. We're gonna walk this road to glory,
children,
my Lord and I.
Yes, we're gonna
walk this road to glory, children, my Lord and I. We're gonna walk and tell the story, children, my Lord and I.
Rain or shine,
snow or sleet,
blessed Lord, guide my feet.
We're gonna walk this road to glory,
children,
my Lord and I.
Such is my consolation, burdens out of the way. The Holy Spirit guides me as I travel day by day. I just pull into the station and I get a full supply.
Well, we're gonna
walk this road to glory,
children,
my Lord and I. We're gonna walk and talk all the way to glory. Gonna walk and tell the blessed all the story. Walk and talk all the way to glory, my Lord and I. When I come to the river wide, the blessed Lord is gonna calm the tide. We're gonna walk this road to glory,
children,
my Lord and I.
My Lord and I.
Well, we're gonna
walk and talk all the way to glory. Gonna walk and tell the blessed all the story. Walk and talk all the way to glory, my Lord and I. When I come to the river wide, the blessed Lord is gonna calm the tide. We're gonna walk this road to glory,
children,
my Lord and I. Ooh.
Thanks, gentlemen. James Carson, Mike Hughes, Nathan Hanley, and Trevor Hanley. Thank you so much. God, we pray a simple prayer of thanksgiving. Even in difficult times, you are with us, and there's nothing that can separate us from that blessing. As we leave here now, help us to remember. No, God, we want to change that phrase. Help us to experience that you are truly with us, leading us and guiding us and giving what we need. Thank you for that, God, that we might then be lights into the lives of people around us. Thank you for this time of worship together, and thank you for your presence that has been here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Just to belong,
just to belong,
just to belong,
just to belong
to a family,
in a family,
God's family,
God's family.
Just to be one,
just to be one
of his daughters and sons,
of his daughters and sons.
What we really want, God's family,
in God's family,
there's a place for me,
there's a place.
God's family.
In God's family.
There's a place for me.
There's a place for me.
In God's family.
In God's family.
There's a place for me.
There's a place for me.
In God's family.
In God's family.
It's where I want to be.
It's where I want to be.
In God's family. May God bless us and keep us. May his countenance, which is gentle and compassionate, shine down upon us both now and always.